our program, we thought it'd be appropriate to hear from a real leader in the transportation engineering profession. Please welcome NSPE President-elect Mr. Christopher Stone.
Well, good morning. Thanks for braving the traffic to get here so early. I want to add my welcome. The National Society of Professional Engineers, or NSPE, is a society of engineering professionals from all engineering disciplines. And we work to promote the ethical and competent practice of engineering and promote professional engineering licensure for every engineer. For the last 75 years, NSPE has represented licensed professional engineers and served the public by promoting the competent and ethical practice of engineering. As a licensed professional engineer, we take an oath and have the responsibility to protect the health, safety, and welfare of the public in the practice of engineering. So how many of you are considering a future in engineering? How many of you are already enrolled in a program or maybe have been accepted to a college that has an engineering program? Quite a few. How many undecideds do we have? A couple undecideds. Who's here because they got out of class today? See, there's always a couple, you know? There's always a couple. Well, for those of you that are considering a future in engineering or undecided, I was about at that same place about 30 years ago. My background is that I am an Army brat. My father was a career Army officer. He was highly decorated, served in three wars. And the Army was all that my three brothers and I really knew as a profession. We followed my father around the country and overseas at different duty assignments. In fact, I went to three different high schools. My father finally retired and I was a senior in high school, and he became the superintendent of a military high school in Virginia, and that's where I attended my last year of high school and actually graduated from. Now, my brothers and I, we always knew that we would go into the military since that's all we'd ever known. So when I graduated from high school, I started looking around for military colleges, and I applied and was accepted to Virginia Military Institute. My older brother had already gone off to military college in Georgia, and not being one to follow in his footsteps, I chose my own path and decided on VMI. The summer before going to school, I would talk to my parents about my major. And since obviously I had to major in something, I really had no idea what I wanted to major in. I just figured I would go to VMI, and in 4 years I would get out and start my career in the Army, like my father and brother before me, so my major was really not all that important. So the day came when I matriculated to VMI, and I still had not selected a major. But you have to understand one thing. When I started high school, I went to my father and asked, "What foreign language should I take?" He said, "Take French. It's the international language." Well, 3 years later, I finished high school French, and I vowed never, ever, ever again to take a foreign language. So on my first day at VMI, you're directed down to the gymnasium, where they have a series of tables set up in alphabetical order, where you declare your major. So I walked up to the first table, and it happened to be civil engineering. And I asked the professor sitting behind the table, I said, "If I major in civil engineering, do I have to take a foreign language?" And he said no, so I signed up. And that's how I became an engineer. 4 years later, I graduated with a degree in civil engineering, and I have never once regretted the choice to major in civil engineering. I love the technology and the practical application of what I was learning in college. You just don't learn math and physics to pass an examination, but to solve real-world engineering problems. Computers were also just starting to come of age. I remember we had one mainframe computer on campus that actually would fill this room. And for my senior project, I was only able to use the computer at night because my project, the analysis of a concrete hyperbolic paraboloid roof shell, took so much computational time that they limited my usage from midnight to 6 o'clock in the morning. Today, there's probably 1,000 times more power in an everyday laptop, or probably your iPhone, than we had in our college mainframe computer. That's how much technology has changed. So just imagine the technological changes that you will see in your lifetime. I bet that will be just as dramatic and just as impactful on your life and your career. Now, after graduating from VMI, I applied and was accepted at the University of Virginia. And 18 months later, I completed my master's degree in civil engineering with an emphasis in structural engineering. After an abbreviated tour in the U.S. Army, a requirement upon graduation from VMI, I started my career as a structural engineering intern, and 4 years later, took the professional engineer's exam and became a licensed professional engineer in the state of Virginia. My engineering career has taken me all over the country and the world. Interestingly enough, shortly after receiving my PE license, My boss came to me and he asked if I would be interested in a new engineering assignment in a new office that they had just opened. I accepted, and I moved where? Not France, but actually Madrid, Spain, where I lived for 4 years, and yes, I did learn to finally speak a foreign language and became fluent in Spanish. So the irony in the story is that sometimes things happen for a reason, and also never turn down a chance to learn a foreign language. Over the last 30 years, engineering has taken me around the world. Every day is a set of new challenges, and the projects are all unique. I've worked on everything from large convention center projects to hospitals, to high-tech facilities and schools, industrial facilities, designed bridges and waterfront structures, and even designed three transatlantic abort landing sites for NASA's space shuttle, one in Spain, one in Morocco, and one in West Africa. So there is no end to the types of projects you can work on as an engineer, and no limit to the location of where those projects might be. Now, many fields of engineering are available to you, probably too many to mention, but some of the more well-known engineering majors are civil, environmental, structural, mechanical, and electrical. But other new areas in biomedical, biomechanical, chemical, sustainable, photonics, computer, nuclear, mineral, and agricultural are rapidly gaining ground in popularity. As varied are the disciplines, so too are opportunities for you in engineering. Even in today's less vigorous economic climate, the demand for qualified engineers remains strong. Many economists are predicting a huge brain drain in engineering as many of my generation begin to retire. So it's a real opportunity for you, I think. According to the U.S. Department of Labor, all engineering career fields will have above-average employment growth opportunities through 2016. And fields such as computers, biomedical, sustainability, and environmental engineering are leading the way and expected to have 25% job growth by 2016. It's also interesting to note that in a recent survey completed by the National Association of Colleges and Employers, which tracks college graduates and their job offers, found that degrees in engineering account for 12 out of 15 top-paying majors. Petroleum engineering was by far the highest paying degree with an average starting salary of $83,000 a year, thanks largely in part to the resources' growing scarcity. So the demand for graduates with skills in engineering is increasing, but the real story is the critical need for engineers today and in the future. I think it's true our local and global communities face genuine problems that are going to have to be studied and solved by your generation, not my generation. Call them problems or challenges, they are significant, and they're included but not limited to our country's aging infrastructure, our roads, our bridges, our transit systems, our energy dependence on fossil fuels, our decline in potable drinking water, and our treatment of hazardous materials and wastewater. As our infrastructure deteriorates, we all suffer, individually and in our businesses and government. Traffic congestion, which is probably pretty evident by the lack of folks here, alone costs an estimated nearly $100 billion a year in lost productivity and delays. The infrastructure that used to give the United States a competitive edge has deteriorated to the point that by 2018, it's predicted that Brazil, Russia, China, and India will surpass all the G8 countries in gross domestic product. Now, each year, the American Society of Civil Engineers grades our country's infrastructure using 15 categories. Grades range from a high of C+, for solid waste, and a low to D- for drinking water, inland waterways, levees, roads, and wastewater. Ultimately, the cost to raise all the categories to a minimal acceptable level, mediocre, would cost at least $3 trillion. Perhaps more worrisome is the lack of funding to make the repairs needed to our infrastructure. And as of March 25, 2011, the USA total public debt outstanding was $14.2 trillion, and our 2010 annual GDP was only $14.6 trillion. So it's a fact that we're going to have to do more with less, and engineers of the future will have to both be creative and inventive in their design solutions and in the financing of public works projects. Now, as my generation retires, your generation is left to face these problems and challenges. I, for one, have a tremendous amount of trust in your generation. In large part through engineering and the development of new technologies, we'll excel in the starring role to develop the solutions demanded for our country. Now, I have two children, and they are both young adults, and they hate it when I give advice, which is probably the reason why neither one of them pursued a career in engineering. But somehow I still feel compelled to offer my opinion on two areas that need immediate attention in engineering, in the engineering profession, for which you can play a huge role. And you can play that role right now. The first is the need for diversity within our profession, and the second is to continue the dialogue of sustainability. It's my opinion that any profession should reflect the face of the society, and ours does not. For years, the engineering profession has been a white, male-dominated profession, but thankfully, today, that is changing. And change is good, since a diversity of backgrounds and thinking only yields to better engineering solutions. So NSPE is working closely with the Society of Women Engineers, the National Society of Black Engineers, the National Society of Hispanic Engineers, and others to work jointly to not only remove roadblocks from entering the profession, but to actively promote entering the engineering profession. A higher education organization recently studied the question as to why more women don't choose engineering as a profession. Among the interesting results was this fact, that women may actually have a better capacity to do math and solve engineering problems than men. So, young women in the audience, I suggest that now is the time for you to take this step to help us solve the challenges your generation has presented by way of a career in engineering. Sustainability. No matter what side of the debate you fall on, sustainability is here to stay, and how we solve the problem will play a large role in your quality of life and that of your children. Resources are becoming more and more limited, and society is going to be looking to engineers to solve a very complicated problem. Do you realize that we have destroyed over 97% of the ancient forests in North America, that U.S. farmers and ranchers draw out 20 billion more gallons of water from the ground than are replaced by rainfall, that the Ogallala Aquifer, the largest underwater river serving the Great Plains, will dry up in 20 to 30 years at the current rate of extraction, and that we lose 25 billion tons of topsoil due to erosion every year, all while the population of the world increases at a rate of 70 million people per year. The demands on our natural resources are overwhelming. Our dependence on fossil fuels is staggering, and we're not developing sustainable renewable energy sources fast enough to replace what we are consuming. A very recent study of known oil reserves in the world projected that we have hit the tipping point. Do you think that oil in the world will run out in 500 years? 250 years? Less than 100 years? Actually, at the current rate of consumption, scientists and engineers predict that the world will consume the entire world's oil supply, known oil supply, in as little as 42 years. That will occur in your lifetime. Now, if it sounds like this is a doomsday scenario, that was not my intention, but to point out that we need each and every one of you to pursue a career in engineering, because somewhere out there among you is the solution to each and every one of the challenges we face today. Now, I hope that many of you will take up the challenge and become an engineer. I can't imagine what the world would be like without engineers. And although biased, I can't imagine being in a more creative and rewarding profession and being a professional engineer. Now, in closing, I invite you to seek out either our website or our Facebook page. And I know everybody's on Facebook, because I'm on Facebook. You can learn more about what it takes to become a professional engineer by visiting the NSPE website at nspe.org or look up our Facebook page by searching for NSPE. And as the president-elect of NSPE, my Facebook page is linked to the NSPE Facebook page, and I'd be more than happy to answer any questions that any of you have on engineering profession or to provide links on opportunities for scholarships and entering the engineering profession. So, thank you very much.